Welcome to 558 Parkside Tech, where we talk about tech's past, present, and the future of tech. I'm your tech plug, Mike. I'm still on vacation, but I've been getting a lot of emails about message queues. So today I'll be covering Kafka message queues as well as RabbitMQ. So all you 558ers, future tech creators, stay tuned right after this. 558 Parkside Tech in effect. Park, son. Well, to start talking about message queuing, I thought it would be best to kind of give you a problem. And that way you can see how message queuing solves this problem. Imagine if you were at a bank or you worked for a company and your company is processing credit cards. And let's say you had a good day or a good month and you've got about 1,000 credit card payments. Now I'm going to use API technology. So what's going to happen is we're going to try to send these payments via API to another application at a bank. Now in order for this to happen, both applications have to be up. The application that you're currently in that has the 1,000, in this example, 1,000 credit card payments, and the bank would have to be up. This is called the request response architecture. So both would have to be up for you to be able to send these 1,000 credit card payments over to the bank. We call that in technology coupling. So if one is down, nothing will get processed. So that's the example I'm going to be using. And I want you to keep in mind as I start talking about all three of these message queuing, because they solve this problem. The value of message queuing, it has decouples. It allows you to asynchronously go from one application to the next. Another point is that APIs don't naturally buffer traffic. If the server can't handle the request load of the files that you're sending, the system may crash or even drop requests. So let's talk about RabbitMQ. RabbitMQ uses something called a publish subscriber model. Let's use the example that I gave you earlier and how it would fit in queuing. So the example I gave you earlier with the 1,000 credit card payments and how with the APIs, what you would have to do, but now with queuing and decoupling, what would happen is you would take those 1,000 payments and actually store it in a queue, a publish queue. So all the records would be sitting there waiting to be processed. Now on the other end, the bank would subscribe to that queue. And whenever the bank wanted to, it could pick up those records. Now notice what I said, whenever they wanted to. So I could put those 1,000 credit card payments in a queue at 1 p.m. and the bank could decide that at 6 p.m. they're gonna process it. And then by subscribing, all they would have to do then is run their application at 6 p.m., picking up any records that was in the queue. Also, if any late payments came in, you could also throw that in the queue as well, as long as it's before the bank, who is a subscriber in this case, picks up everything from the queue. Now, how it picks it up is something we call FIFO. That's first in, first out, okay? So FIFO. So if you wanted to know how does it pick it up, it doesn't pick up the last one that was in it. It starts off with the first one that was put in there and it processes it that way. But even in message queuing, there's one small issue. And this will be the difference between one message queue software from another. In this case, once a subscriber picks up all the items that was placed in the queue by the publisher, they're gone. There's no backup. There's no internal storage that will store what you've put in that queue. So what do most companies and systems do? Before they put, in this example, the 1,000 payments in the queue, they back it up onto a database. Then they throw it in the queue and then they send it off and the subscriber will pick up what was in the queue and process it. And sometimes even on the subscriber end, they'll back it up to a database as well. So that's one of the negatives I would say for RabbitMQ is that it does not retain what was put in the queue. Now let's talk about Kafka. Kafka has been around roughly around 2010. It was before that, it was LinkedIn had it. And then Apache ended up getting his hand on the product. And they named it after a guy named Franz Kafka, who was known for his complex, thought-provoking literary works. And the people at Apache felt like it reflected their system's ability to handle complex flows of data and messaging. And they thought that name would be very catching in the industry. And thus they called it that. Now, Kafka is similar to RabbitMQ, and it has one feature that it matches what RabbitMQ does. It does a point-to-point as well, and it does a pub-sub model as well. It does publish and subscribers. So as far as messaging is concerned, it does something similar to what RabbitMQ does. In that, using my example, it would still put the 1,000 credit card payments into a queue using FIFO, and then a subscriber on the other end would subscribe to that particular queue and thus read all the messages. But one of the big differences between Kafka and RabbitMQ is Kafka has a built-in data collector. So you don't lose any messages that you actually put in the queue. There's actual internal database that you can write to keep up with your messages. It also gives you the ability to replay, or if you have any errors or you want to debug maybe what the subscriber is picking up or what you're putting in, you can do that continually because it has a data collector that will collect the items that are in the queue. But one of the biggest differences is Kafka allows data streaming, event streaming. And that's one of the biggest differences why a lot of people are running to Kafka, because of that one main feature and its ability to have a high level of throughput. And with their internal storage, they're allowed to use a retention period to determine how much data they keep and when they should actually roll off data. And that's an ability that some of the other message queues don't give you the ability to do. And also with Kafka publish subscribe system, where producers send messages to topics and consumers subscribe to these topics. Messages are stored persistently in partitions, which also is a little different, across distributed brokers, enabling high availability and scalability. Consumers can process messages in real time. And again, the key I mentioned earlier, you can replay older events and older messages. And last but not least, Kafka's scaling is a little bit different than where RabbitMQ is. RabbitMQ over time, as you put more messages in the queue, sometimes the performance can be degraded. Whereas with Kafka, it scales horizontally. And horizontal scaling is the key for one of its successes and how it goes about handling performance and latency. Now, if you want more detail on how Kafka goes about data streaming, how it handles its pub/sub protocol, click on my video that's just on Kafka, where I go into detail how it goes about doing it and how it can be an important part of a solution for decoupling your applications. Hopefully this short discussion on queuing gave you a better understanding of message queues for those who sent me emails about it. One of the key factors is it allows asynchronous communication. It also allows a decoupling of services and of applications. It's also reliable and fault tolerant because messages are stored in a queue until they're successfully processed or picked up by the subscriber. Also, it's scalable because message queues support scaling by adding more consumers to handle increased payloads. Also, it's used in most of your modern architectures. That's all I got for today. As always, be better than your best excuse and continue to learn tech. Also, remember, whatever you aren't changing, you're accepting. That's just a little side note for those that wrote me emails about a particular subject. All right, go easy. Peace. Thank you for joining me today on this short one-on-one on queues, both RabbitMQ and Kafka. Now, if it was any benefit to you, please hit the like button and subscribe. I always say, don't be a knucklehead. Everybody knows what to do on YouTube. Big Brother's always watching. And as always, I say, be better than your best excuse and continue to learn tech. Make the time each day. And again, whatever you're not changing, you're accepting. So keep that in mind each day as you come into the office or if you're in class learning tech. Again, this is your Tech Plug Mike. That's all I got. 558 out. Peace.
Yeah, 558 Park Site Tech in effect, tech 558 Park Site Tech in effect, tap in the future. Let me introduce ya. 558 Park Site Tech, about to school ya. 558 Park Site Tech in effect, tech 558 Park Site Tech in effect, tech 558 Park Site Tech in effect,
Park, son.